History 112, Lecture 22, Causes of the Great Depression. The Great Depression is the worst economic disaster in American history, and the first obvious sign that something was truly, truly wrong was the stock market crash in 1929. Now, we should realize that the 18 months previous to the crash, we're seeing a period where stock prices are going to double in value, trading is going to increase from 2 to 3 million shares to over 5 million shares being traded daily. In other words, the market is really picking up and really boosting itself. Now, the key thing to realize is that stocks are worth what people are willing to pay for them, so market confidence becomes a thing. Now, in September 1929, that confidence starts to diminish and there's a slide in stock prices. Now, by October 21st and 23rd, we're starting to see big dips and quick recoveries. And what the quick recoveries are all about is J.P. Morgan and a number of other financiers trying to buy up all the shares they could to boost that market confidence back in. The key thing about the stock market is it relies on people investing, and people are not going to invest if they don't feel like they're going to get their money out. And with stock prices being so high and overinflated, people feel like anything they buy at this point is likely to be a loss. And that leads to Black Thursday and then Black Tuesday. Now, Black Thursday is October 24th, and it's the largest sell-off in New York Stock Exchange history, and Black Tuesday is an outright crash. What we should realize is that $40 billion in stock value is going to be lost between the end of October and December. Only 16 million shares are going to be traded during that same time period. We go from 5 million shares being traded a day to 16 million shares being traded over 3 months, and a lot of stocks are simply worthless because the companies are out of business or people are simply unwilling to buy them in the first place. While the stock market crash is the obvious sign of the beginning of the Great Depression, there were a lot of underlying causes that led to it. First and foremost, there's overproduction. All the unchecked corporate expansion in the 1920s had led to inefficient businesses that were piling up far more than they could reasonably sell, to the point that by 1929, some companies were sitting on 3 years' worth of inventory. There was also a lack of diversification in the American economy. The prosperity of the 1920s was built on construction and auto industries. New industries like chemicals and plastics were not strong enough to take up the slack when there's a setback in the economy that affects the primary industries of automobiles and construction. There's also severe uneven distribution of income and wealth. The poor distribution of purchasing power among consumers goes right with that. Farm income was down 66% in the 1920s. By 1929, the top 10% of the nation's population received 40% of the nation's disposable income. In other words, only the really wealthy were able to continue to make large purchases. And without the lower class, the working class, and even by this point in the Great Depression, the middle class, being able to continue to purchase goods, there was no way to stimulate the economy back so those businesses could recover. On top of that, internationally, there was less demand for American goods. Europe had been recovering from World War I, and now they're producing more goods at home, so they were no longer as reliant on American imports. Some European countries, like Germany, could no longer afford those imports anyway. And the Allied nations were dependent on Germany to pay back their war debts, and they were beginning to struggle to repay their war loans when Germany was struggling to repay those war loans. And we get into a cycle in Europe that means Europeans are dialing back their expenses in order to help meet their debts, and none of that money is going to buy American goods. In addition, consumer debt, especially middle class buying and installment loans, is going to be a major problem because there's a lot of just money out there in debt. And when people start to lose their jobs and the economy dials back, people can't repay those, and that puts strain on the banking industry, as does the overspeculation of the stock market. Now, what had happened was wealthy and upper middle class people have been buying stocks on credit, and that worked well in the beginning because you can buy a stock for one price, wait a couple of weeks, sell it for a profit, and repay your loan and pocket the difference. And that worked really well until the stock market prices started to fall, at which point people had to sell off their stocks. The only problem was the stocks were worth less than the balance of the loan, so that's going to put a major strain on the banking industry as people are defaulting on those obligations. And the banking industry itself is not very strong at this point. There have been a lot of bank failures in the 1920s because farm prices had fallen. That meant farmers have been unable to repay their loans, and that had put a major strain on the banking industry, as had all of the credit they were extending. So you get to the point by the early 1930s where banks have very small cash reserves. They don't have enough money to go around, so they are unable to pay their obligations and have to fold. The total money supply is part of the problem here as well because there's just not enough currency to go around. And all of this combines to mean bank failures. About 20% of all banks, over 6,000 of them, are going to close in the first 3 years of the Depression. By 1933, it's another 3,000, so it's up to 50% of the banks are going to fail in the first 4 years of the Depression because they simply cannot collect on the loans that are out there. Over $90 million in savings accounts are going to be lost to consumers. That's about $2.5 billion of today's money. It just goes poof for the people who had put their money in the bank. So if you were just a regular working class individual who had put some money in the bank, it was gone. You couldn't get it back. There was just nowhere for you to go because that bank had closed and you were out of luck. Now this is going to lead to the Federal Reserve System that we'll talk about later. And there are some immediate changes that come out of these bank failures, but they're a subject for a little later on. We should keep in mind the stock market crash does not cause the Great Depression. The American economy had a huge number of weaknesses to the point where it could not withstand the shock. It's more of a domino effect. Any single area of the American economy, if it had a major setback, could have set off a chain of events that would have crashed the whole. The stock market crash happens to be the one that actually does it. It's not itself the cause. And we should know that the economy being so weak, once that set of dominoes starts to fall, the gross national product, the total amount of production in the country, falls from $104 billion down to $56 billion in the space of about 4 years. Total national income that same time is going to fall 50%. Corporate profits are going to fall from $10 billion to $1 billion. And there are going to be 100,000 business failures in the first 4 years. So think about it this way, there is the crash, and during the crash, investors are going to lose millions, and businesses' profits are going to go down. Businesses are going to have problems, and they're going to start laying off workers, which is going to lead to a drop in consumer spending. And businesses are going to cut down on investments and cut down on production while some others fail because there's no one to buy their goods, and that goes in a cycle. Meanwhile, those businesses cannot pay back loans to the banks, and the banks are going to run out of money and fail. And when those banks start to fail, people go to try to remove all their bank accounts before it's too late, so savings accounts are wiped out, and banks again may find it more difficult to pay their existing obligations. Meanwhile, internationally, the allies cannot afford to pay debts to the United States. So, you're seeing money not go into the banks, having knock-on effects there. And those banks being weak, they're unable to use those monies to help businesses. So production is going to plummet, and U.S. investors are going to have little or no money to invest. So U.S. investment abroad, in particular in Germany, is going to decline. And the Germans are not going to be able to pay their war debts, which means they cannot pay their European counterparts, who cannot afford American goods, and so on. And what you get is a series of cycles where money just goes in a downward spiral, and it becomes harder and harder for businesses to stay open and employ American workers. So what's the big idea here? Well, a stock market crash is going to put huge strain on the U.S. economy. Banks are going to fail, businesses are going to fail, and the whole economy is going to come crashing down. But remember, this is all the result of long-term weaknesses in the U.S. economy, and it's going to take a decade to recover. This is going to be a major issue that's going to cause a complete realignment of the American economy to come back out of this. See you in the next lecture.